Who can love me like you do?
I can be prone to wonder, too full of pride sometimes. I don't make it easy to love this heart of mine. I can get so distracted, caught up in doubt and fear. But every time I think you've left me, you're still right here.
I don't want them honking at me. See? Howdy. How are you? That's to drown you out, Mayor. Welcome to Salem United Methodist Church. This is our outdoor version. It's worked well. This is our world famous community time, when we share announcements and concerns and praises. This has already been a special day here at Salem. Our church organ has arrived. It's been returned and ready for another 50 years. I know that Tina Han and Marie are glad it's back where it belongs. So it took a while, but it'll be worth it. I'm going to review the prayer list and announcements first. We're going to have prayer requests for Marge Curry, who we think is still in Florida, but she could have been brought back home this week. We're not sure, but keep Marge in your prayers. The Han family, with the passing of Jerry, he was a brother of Eric. Sarah Johnson, who is still recovering from her back surgery. Danita Ho, as she recovers from back surgery. DeAndrea Spear, recovering from rotator cuff surgery, sister of Danelle. The children and the entire school staff throughout the world as they return to learning both in a classroom and virtually. Rush and Ruth Harmon, prayers for them. Praises. It's always good to have praises. Praises for Sister Myra, Eric's sister, whose health has improved. Tina Han's health is back to normal. Right? Good. All right. And Judy Smith, who is Carrie Hamron's mother, is doing a lot better. And I was just given another request for prayers. This is from Charlene Ramsey. her cousin Tony and his wife Robin Sumner. Tony and Robin Sumner from Cicero, but they're now living in Naples. They are both suffering from COVID-19, and there's nothing more they can do for Tony. Also, Charlene's husband, Gerald, is going in for surgery soon, and he needs our prayers as well. So that family definitely needs our prayers. That's really all I have. Upcoming events, we're going to have a picnic today. Beautiful day, no rain, sun, not too hot. Monday is still Bible study, 6:30, Zoom. And there's a trustees meeting Tuesday at 6:30. Birthdays, we do have some birthdays. On the 18th of this month is Brenda Ward. The 20th is Chuck Cameron Jr. 21st is Roy King Jr. And 22nd is Richie Thatcher. Age? 51, that's a good number, that's a good number. And we have one anniversary on the 18th is Chris and Lisa Isaacs, okay? I don't know how many, but okay. Not many. Oh, that's them, isn't it? How about one, maybe two? I was thinking for mom and dad, okay. Two, okay. Come out your way, see what you got to say.
Anybody? I'd like to ask a prayer request for our daughter, Marla Ada. Marla just found out a couple days ago she has type 1.5 diabetes. I don't know what type 1.5 is. I had never heard of it either. It's obviously between 1 and 2, but it's closer to 1 than it is 2. It's for the, it's an autoimmune disease where the enzymes in your body attack the pancreas ability to produce insulin. So she's really struggling right now to accept that and figure out how she can do it. So,
thank you.
Over here, anybody?
She's been through a lot. She's doing well, isn't she? She's going to be fine. Yeah. Anybody else on this side? Anybody?
First of all, prayers for the Rogers family, as we know him. Terry Rogers, I imagine he's in his late 50s, early 60s, right around that age. And he passed away unexpectedly yesterday. He's a long-time veteran. Clients will report to the first of his family. Also, it is that time where the information committee are filling the spaces, and we have several spaces available that we need to fill. So if you're feeling led, please come to the after church today or contact me through email, text, call, whatever works for you. We also need to know if you are not planning on doing any of the positions for next year, I need to know that too at that point.
Those are positions for the administrative board, right? On the board. Other committees.
Over one of my friends in school has gone into the
sorry for your loss.
Brian Earnhardt here. Just want to thank you for all the work you folks are doing to keep the services going during the summer. Very nice.
That's Paul.
Yeah.
Paula, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
I know that you mentioned briefly Rush Settlers, but I spoke to you last night, and Rush fell this week. Okay, she's in the car. All right, great. I think she's in. All right.
Grace and Ruth can always have prayers. Prayers are good. I checked with
Pastor Gina if I could mention this, and she gave her okie dokie. Did you know that heaven is a gated community? There is a gate. Now, you don't get to just drive up there, walk up there, and put your four-digit number. That doesn't work. And you don't get a little pass card to put your number in. That doesn't work. You better go prepared. Just so you know, it is gated. You do have to have your dues paid. They will check on your dues. Next, I want to introduce, everybody knows Eric. Eric is representing trustees. He's a member of the trustee committee, and he's got some interesting comments I think you'll be interested in hearing.
You probably already noticed we have a couple new ads in the parking lot this morning. So in case you're wondering what that's about, the trustees have decided to make a substantial investment in the refurbishment of Salem, the building, the facility. There will be repair activities going on, some remodeling, but mostly in repairs and preservation activities of our existing structure. A lot of things are on the list. There's a whole write-up available. But to give you a few highlights as to questions and what's going on, some of the projects, there's a couple roof leaks, one in the southwest corner there above the choir room, one in the flat part of the roof on the southeast corner. Those will be addressed, taken care of. There'll be a major project that's actually about five projects combined, and that'll be a full exterior rehabilitation of Salem, including all the siding replaced, adding insulation, which there's currently not insulation in that old building. There'll be a remediation of the bat situation and get that removed, cleaned up, disinfected, and everything there. And then with the siding replacement, hopefully it'll be tight enough to keep them from coming back. Later in November timeframe, I think it is, the stained glass windows will be addressed as far as further preserving a little bit of repair and preservation activity needed on those as well to preserve those wonderful stained glass windows. Also on the list, the front steps, the concrete work, front steps to be replaced, including new handrails. That'll be underway. So what we're doing is trying to coordinate a lot of projects that have kind of been on the to-do list for a long time. But since we're displaced out of the church anyway, and we have the tent here available, we'll be extending the tent services during the construction period while we can address some of these issues. We're basically staying within the same footprint of the existing structure. There had been some discussion about potential ideas to add on and things like that, but given the current situation, we'll address in preserving the beautiful asset that we presently have. So any questions can be directed to any of the trustees. We've had numerous meetings and discussions. A special thanks to Andy Milhop for his expertise and guidance and meeting with contractors and a lot of time he has spent in kind of coordinating some of these activities. So starting tomorrow, the upper part of the sanctuary there will be off limits due to construction. The lower part is accessible on a limited basis. We want to keep the restrooms open and functional and that type of thing, but try to avoid a need of going upstairs during this construction period. So Rather than read the prepared outline here or all the details, I'll leave this for reference. If anyone wants to read it, you're welcome to during the picnic thing. So we'll keep that in mind. That's, I think, most of my comments at the moment, other than keep Salem in your prayers. The current building fund is sufficient to undergo these projects and this work, but we will need to replenish that on a future basis. So thanks to all those that have contributed to the building fund over these many years, and it's a good position to be in, and we want to try to do as much as we can in short order this fall while we have the tent facility. And so we won't take questions now, but I wanted to make some comments, kind of give you an update on the big picture of what's going on and why, and the details, you can get those by asking any of us. So, did I leave anything out pertinent? Very good. Thanks. Oh, one other thing. Keep the construction crews in your prayers as well for their safety, and hope everything goes well on this endeavor.
Good morning. Now it's time for our call to worship. Thankful for God's presence with us, knowing that God loves us and cares for us, believing in the power of prayer, and anticipating that we will be strengthened for the challenge of the week ahead. Let us worship the Lord our God. Our hymn of adoration is Breathe on Me, Breath of God.
With thy fire.
Now it's time for our Apostles' Creed, and anyone that would like to, you may join me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Testament lesson this morning, I've got a question for you. Our song of inspiration is Do Lord. How many knew beforehand? Because I just figured this out yesterday. So, you know, for 62 years I've been doing it wrong. Do Lord doesn't have a question mark in it. Do Lord has a period in it. It's a statement, not a question. So it's not Do Lord, do you remember me? It's Do Lord, remember me. A statement. So when you show up at Larry's Pearly Gates, do Lord remember me. So I just thought I'd throw that in. A little, it hit me yesterday, and I'm just learn something new every day. And for me, there's a lot to learn. Okay, our Old Testament lesson this morning is Genesis 45, verses 1 through 15. Last week they sold Joseph off into slavery in Egypt. This kind of follows up with it. Joseph could stand it no longer. Out, all of you, he cried to his attendants, and he was left alone with his brothers. Then he wept aloud. His sobs could be heard throughout the palace, and the news was quickly carried to the Pharaoh's palace. I am Joseph, he said to his brothers. Is my father still alive? But his brothers couldn't say a word. They were so stunned with surprise. Come over here, he said. So they came closer. And again he asked. He said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt. But don't be angry with yourselves that you did this to me, for God did it. He sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. These 2 years of famine will grow to seven, during which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God has sent me here to keep you and your families alive, so you will become a great nation. Yes, it was God who sent me here, not you. And he has made me a counselor to Pharaoh and manager of his entire nation, ruler of all the land of Egypt. Hurry, return to my father and tell him, your son Joseph says, God has made me chief of all the land of Egypt. Come down to me right away. You shall live in the land of Goshen so that you can be near me with all your children and your grandchildren, your flocks and herds, and all that you have. I will take care of you there. You men are witness to my promise, and my brother Benjamin has heard me say it. For there are still 5 years of famine ahead of us. Otherwise, you will come to utter poverty along with all of your household. Tell our father about all the power here in Egypt, and how everyone obeys me, and bring him to me quickly. Then, weeping with joy, he embraced Benjamin, and Benjamin began weeping too. And he did the same thing with each of his brothers, who finally found their tongues. This ends the reading of Genesis 45, verses 1 through 15.
It's prayer time. And I'm going to go ahead and warn you now. I may start dancing with Do Lord. So anyway, if I do, it's okay. It's okay. It's holy dancing. All right. Let us pray. Most gracious God, we truly thank you for a beautiful day. Another day to come and worship you. Another day to be with our sisters and brothers. Another day to be able to breathe the fresh air. To be able to hear the birds sing. To be able to smell the freshly cut grass. All of our senses, Lord, we want a taste of the spiritual food that you have for us today. And Lord, for all of this, we thank you. We thank you from the bottom of our hearts. God, right now there are folks who are very anxious, very worried, not knowing what's going to happen. And God, we ask right now for a triple portion of your grace and mercy to fall upon us so that we will be able to help those who need their fears calmed, that your spirit rises within them so that they're able to make it one more day. Lord, we're asking that you bless those who are suffering with COVID. You know, Lord, only you know what the future holds for us. And God, right now there are still new cases. We ask, Lord, that you protect those who are sick, protect those who are caring for those people, protect those who are cleaning, protect those who are removing trash, protect those who are essential. And Lord, in your sight, we are all essential for you, and you are so essential to us. Lord, right now we lift up our own prayer concerns, and we're lifting them up into the open air. And Father, let us pray together in a whispered tone, as Jesus taught his disciples, when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do remember me. Way beyond the blue, I got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. I got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. I got a home in glory land that outshines the sun. Way beyond the blue. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Way beyond the blue. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take him too. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take him too. I took Jesus as my Savior, you take him too. Way beyond the blue. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do
Lord, oh do Lord, oh do remember me. Do Lord, oh do remember me. Way beyond the blue.
Yay! That was peppy. I like that. Alrighty, this is would be the time that we would take up our offering. And there have been people who have been sending their checks in, doing it electronically. The little box that's on the way in. And we thank you for that. And we thank God for the opportunity. So let us pray over our offering. O Lord, as we present your tithe and these gifts, we pray that they may be pleasing to you, for they are given out of the love and gratitude in our hearts for all your good gifts. Use them, Lord, we pray, for the good of your kingdom, that others may know of your bountiful mercy. Together we say, amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome to all the children this morning, young and old alike. I gotta ask you, can anybody tell me memory verse from the Sunday school lesson this week? No? Okay. So one of these weeks, one of you are going to have to surprise me and have it memorized. Lesson 11. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. That comes from Mark 10, 43 through 44. I encourage you to go to your Bible and read that scripture and do your Sunday school lesson. All right. Who has confidence that this can be a helpful tool? Who has confidence? Okay, everybody thinks that this old flashlight can be a pretty good helpful tool. Pardon? If it has batteries. So it could potentially fail you, although it is a useful item. Okay. Okay, Margaret has a valid point. The batteries could be in there, but they could be expired or corroded or whatever. But you would go to this item and assume it could help you. You would have confidence that a flashlight could be a handy little tool. Okay. Now, I realize this may be an antique item to Ruth, or perhaps even to Lane and Reese, but this is an alarm clock. And this is the kind of alarm clock that I would have used to help me make sure I got up for school. Now, most of you would say that you could trust in an alarm clock, right? Okay, but you have to remember to wind it. Okay? And sometimes, for some unknown reason, clocks run a little fast, they gain time, or they lose time. Now this is, again, I know, this is an old-fashioned clock, and perhaps you have a digital clock now, and you don't even have this kind, and it's never an issue. But you would generally say you could rely on an alarm clock to help you get up in the morning like you're supposed to, on time, for work. All right. So, you all have items you trust and you rely on. Ruth, what would I use these for? To start my car. So, this handy dandy key is something I can trust in. What if the car battery is dead?
Oh, Lord.
What if I get, I don't know, half a mile, tire, flat tire. Anybody ever run out of gas? Keys in the ignition, but yeah, if there's no gas. Oh, Brian's chilling on Molly. I confess I have run out of gas too. Okay, so you think you can get just a little bit farther. Your trust in that car. All right, so we all have objects in our daily life that we trust that can help us. Yes, we have confidence in them. We depend on them. But we've pointed out that batteries can be an issue. Winding, there's issues with the car. You can even have a flat tire. Oh, and we have witnessed the trustworthy electronics that Mr. Overman uses over here to have service. Sometimes they let us down. Now, our scripture today comes from Matthew 15, 21 to 28. And it tells us of a Canaanite woman that with tremendous humility and trust, she approached the Lord Jesus. Help me, help me. She had so much confidence and faith in the Lord, and she wasn't even a Jew. She was those other people in that time frame who weren't supposed to know about him, weren't supposed to trust, didn't even know he was coming. They hadn't been told the Messiah was coming. But she believed, she trusted wholeheartedly, and she knew that God could help her. She knew all she had to do was ask. How confident are you, Ruth, that you can ask God to help you with anything? I'm sorry? 9 out of 10. Oh, 10 out of 10. Okay, my hearing's bad. Shoo! I was a little worried there for a minute. Now, can you ask God to help you get an A on your exam, Lane? Yes, you can, because you're asking him to help you be confident in your answers and calm so you can take that test well and get an A, right? Okay. Can you ask him to heal you? Okay. Can you ask him to make that bully on the playground stop picking on you, Ruth? Yes. Okay. All right. Nick, can you ask God to help you get a hit at the plate when you're playing baseball? Oh, Nick.
He said yeah.
Is he shaking his head?
He said yeah.
He's saying yes. Okay, so there is nothing you can't go to God and ask for, right? Help with. He's not going to make you rich. You're not going to find a pot of gold, Ruth. You're not going to be able to buy the biggest doll in the aisle of the toy store. You can ask, but it's probably not going to happen. You could ask God to guide Grandma to the biggest doll in the aisle. There you go. Okay, so, and Grandma's a pushover, isn't she? All right, the point is, and I think you all understand, that trust in the Lord, complete and total trust, Ruth, Lane, Reese. I've been forgetting that you are part of my children too, and I've been leaving you out, so I'm picking on you extra today, all right? Okay, and it tells us, I want to read another verse to you, as I told you about Matthew. Young or old, it doesn't matter. You can always go to God and ask for help. And it tells us in Jeremiah 17:7, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. I pray that each of you have confidence in the Lord to give you what you need.
Okay, before I get started, I'm going to need a volunteer, because in case a little breeze blows up and my papers fly, I'll need somebody that's got really good legs to go run. Alrighty. Our New Testament lesson this morning. Well, I know I can take my mask down, because we were at annual conference virtually, and there were people that were making comments that they could not understand what the bishop was saying because of the mask, plus being able to see the mouth. So we've got enough distance, so we're good. All right. And mine comes down. They were having a horrible time trying to untie them, and it was funny. But anyway, okay. Matthew, 15th chapter, 21st through the 28th verses. Hear you now the word of the Lord. Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David! My daughter is tormented by a demon!" But he didn't answer her at all. And his disciples came and they urged him, saying, Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us. And then he answered, "I was only sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and she knelt down before him and she says, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "Is it not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs?" And she said, "Yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with and for me? Speak, Lord. Speak to and through me. Help me, Lord. Help me to be able to break the bread of life with my brothers and my sisters. Speak, Lord. Speak to us and fill us, Lord, with your precious Holy Spirit. And all of God's people said, Amen. Over the past few weeks, we've spoken about positive aspects of being sown and planting seeds within lives. And as I read this week's gospel, I wanted to think about another aspect, one of which we might not often consider, even though we see it at work so much in our lives. I promise I won't hold you too long today, because, you know, I've been learning that it doesn't take a whole long time to get the final message through. So, I want to just share for a few moments on the topic, faith that Jesus can do it. Can anybody say Jesus can do it? Y'all did that real nice. Didn't make it real loud where you're blowing up breath all over everywhere, but you had that in there. That was good. That was good. So, Jesus himself said, "I can do it." Because he said to the woman, "Great is your faith. Let it be done as you wish." And so the story of the Canaanite woman, earlier in my study, I really had trouble with this particular passage because I thought, man, Jesus was awfully mean. And we know that God loves us all. But why would he be so mean to that lady? So let's talk about that a minute. The story of this Canaanite woman is the an extension of a previous teaching that Jesus, he was teaching on clean and unclean things. And Canaanites were Gentiles, and as such, their entire group of people were considered unclean by the laws of Judaism. Now, this passage is quite difficult to interpret because the conversation between Jesus and the woman appears to be filled with bias. Now, first, Jesus ignored her in verse 23. Then, in verse 24, he excluded her. And then, finally, he insulted her using the name that Jews commonly call for Gentiles. Dogs. Even the dogs. Who let the dogs out? No, I'm at church. Dog. Oh, dog came out again. Oh! The woman, by contrast, was a model of godly virtue. She persisted in spite of being ignored, and she addressed Jesus with terms indicating some identification with his faith. She called him Son of David. Oh, Gentiles knowing him as Son of David? And which, that was a messianic title. And then later she called him Lord. And she would not go away until she had received help from her sick daughter. She was tenacious. I like that word. She was tenacious. She was going to keep on until she got something done. Now, where was the turning point in this passage? The woman did not get her needs met simply by addressing Jesus as espousing her theology or Christology. I had to throw those seminary words in there, okay? Jesus, the Son of David. Nor did her acknowledgement of him as Lord get her through to get his attention. It was her observation that even the dogs were permitted to eat the crumbs that fell from their master's table. Even the dogs. And so, she's saying, well, Lord, even me, a Gentile, can eat the crumbs from the master's table. When Jesus heard that, that was, wow. She knows, she believes, her faith is great. And so, the Canaanite woman's insistence that God was compassionate compelled Jesus to applaud her faith. And with her commitment to Jesus and her persistence in trying to get to him, the Canaanite woman knew that in her life, she had faith that Jesus can do it. Can somebody say Jesus can do it? All right. Yeah. Oh, that sounds even better. Y'all getting this. Okay, so in our lives here at Salem, we might feel that because we're a small congregation, our attendance has been less than capacity, which is down from the glory years. And if we don't begin to seek out the lost, the last, and the least, that things could begin to look pretty grim for our parish. And if we don't intentionally, I'm getting ready to test you, intentionally begin to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. We'll try that one more time, because I know we're whispering to keep that down, but our main focus is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And so, y'all, I stopped by this morning to let you know that when we strengthen our relationship with Christ, we will have a better understanding of our faith that Jesus can do it. Whatever it is that we need in Jesus' name, we ask, he will do it. He can do it. And so the four parents of this church, and maybe even some of the people here in this tent and out on the parking lot who have been part of Salem all their lives, have helped this church, have helped this vineyard to survive with the help of God these 186 years, because they believe in their hearts that they had faith that Jesus can do it. Now, as I prepare to close, y'all, and I don't look at your watches, okay? Because I really am getting ready to prepare to close. Today, we may feel like we have too many things in our lives going on, with all the social distancing, with all the projects that we've got going on here, with all the things that we've got to do extra because of COVID, all the things we've got going on. We've got Zoom meetings that we've got to attend. We've got all kinds. You know, it's really hard for us to go to our friends' houses and have parties, and it's just, there's just so much going on right now. But this vineyard, I believe, and this is Gina's belief, is committed to Christ. This vineyard does whatever it takes to make sure that the message gets out. I mean, not many churches have FM receivers. Not many churches have big, nice big signs saying that we have outdoor worship. And to hear tell, there are still some churches that have not gathered yet. I believe Salem is committed to Christ. I believe that Salem has the faith that Jesus can do it. We may say to ourselves that, you know, I may not eloquently be able to pray in public. I may not be able to take that big risk to introduce someone to Christ. I may not know how to share the gospel to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And I, you know, I just may not even know what to say. There may even be some people saying, I've been praying to God about this certain thing, about this certain person, for a long time, and I haven't seen the fruit of that yet. Or maybe I just don't think I'm good enough for Jesus. There may be some of us right here in this space that have those feelings. But I'm here to tell you, this short little old woman with my little teeny tiny feet, believe, I came to tell you, the Lord can make a way out of no way. When you think you can't go another step, Lord, take my hand. Lead me on. Jesus can do it. Jesus can bring you through whatever it is, as long as you have the faith in you. Amen. That was good. That was good. That was good. That was good. It's one of my favorite songs, too. Okay, benediction. May your faith be strong. May your mind be at peace. May your soul be filled with faith and hope. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. I'm just going to bless the food as we get our little lunch areas together. I'm going to stay for a little bit, and then I'm going to go home and go get some sleep. Lord, bless this time together. Bless this family of believers. Bless the food that we are about to partake, as you've already blessed the spiritual food we've received. Lord, we can't stop love, even in the midst of COVID-19. And let us be together in faith, hope, and love. Amen.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation. Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus.
Each year, a mission project is selected for the annual conference session. And for 2020, we chose Stuff the Bus. We would park a school bus somewhere prominently on the IW campus and ask you to fill it with school supplies. And since our host city is Marion, we would focus on the Marion Community Schools, a school district where over 70% of the students are on the free or reduced price meals, which is an indication of the financial position of the families in this district. Stuff the Bus would be a way for us to help students who couldn't afford the school supplies they needed. It'd be a way for us to really show love in action. That was the plan. Then the pandemic changed all that. The plans for the conference itself changed. Far fewer of us would visit the campus, so far fewer donations. Even without that, the idea of visiting stores to buy things, loading a bus, unloading a bus, was a lot of handling at a time when handling isn't really a good thing. The pandemic was also having an economic impact on across the entire state, making it likely that more students would be impacted. So this changed our thinking about who we could help and how. We needed a new plan. Same theme though, stuff the bus. But to avoid physically handling school supplies, we decided to accept online financial donations instead. Details are going to go up on the screen now about how to do it, and they will be posted on the INUMC website as well. You see, we still wanted to support the Marion Community Schools as originally planned, but we also wanted to help some of the other schools across the state of Indiana. The way we'll do that is that 30% of your donations will go to Marion Community Schools, with the remaining 70% equally divided among the 10 districts. And each district ops team then will determine which school or schools will receive a donation for the purchase of school supplies to assist students who need help buying them. And we trust the schools to determine the best way to do this. Unfortunately, they do this a lot. Now, I have to tell you, it would have been great fun to converge on Marion and fill up that school bus. Because donating money doesn't seem near as much fun as seeing a full bus leave the parking lot. But since that can't happen, let's not forget what this is about. This is about helping students. We're helping a student who has little or no influence on their financial position. And there are a lot of us. So if each of us can donate something, it can make a big difference. $20, $30, $40 would have a significant impact. Some may be able to donate just a bit more. You can even invite your friends to help. These young people are our future, and school helps them with their future. Together, we can make a difference for them. So I hope you'll help. I hope you'll donate. Thank you.